ఢిల్లీలో జరుగుతున్న అంతర్జాతీయ న్యాయ సదస్సులో జస్టిస్ ఎన్వి రమణ ప్రసంగిస్తున్నారు. ప్రత్యక్ష ప్రసారం ద్వారా చూద్దాం.
జస్టిస్ ఎల్ నాగేశ్వరరావు, ఆనరబుల్ జడ్జెస్ ఆఫ్ ది సుప్రీం కోర్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా, శ్రీ కెకె వేణుగోపాల్, అటార్నీ జనరల్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా, రెస్పెక్టెడ్ డెలిగేట్స్ అండ్ రిప్రజెంటేటివ్స్ ఫ్రమ్ అక్రాస్ ది గ్లోబ్, ఆనరబుల్ చీఫ్ జస్టిస్ అండ్ జడ్జెస్ ఆఫ్ ది హైకోర్ట్, సొలిసిటర్ జనరల్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా అండ్ అదర్ లా ఆఫీసర్స్, చైర్మన్ ఆఫ్ బార్ కౌన్సిల్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా, ప్రెసిడెంట్ అండ్ మెంబర్స్ ఆఫ్ ది ఎగ్జిక్యూటివ్ ఆఫ్ ది సుప్రీం కోర్ట్ బార్ అసోసియేషన్, రెస్పెక్టివ్ అడ్వకేట్స్, డైరెక్టర్స్ ఆఫ్ జ్యుడిషియల్ అకాడమీస్, మెంబర్ సెక్రటరీస్ ఆఫ్ లీగల్ సర్వీస్ అథారిటీస్, మెంబర్స్ ఆఫ్ ది ప్రెస్, లేడీస్ అండ్ జెంటిల్మెన్, గుడ్ మార్నింగ్, నమస్కార్. ఐ మస్ట్ స్టేట్ దట్ ఇట్ గివ్స్ మీ గ్రేట్ ప్లెజర్ టు వెల్కమ్ దిస్ ఆగస్ట్ గ్యాదరింగ్ కంప్రైజింగ్ ఆఫ్ జడ్జెస్, జ్యూరీస్ అండ్ లా ప్రాక్టీషనర్స్ ఫ్రమ్ అక్రాస్ ది వరల్డ్ అండ్ టు ఇంట్రడ్యూస్ ది టాపిక్స్ దట్ వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు డిస్కస్ ఇన్ దిస్ కాన్ఫరెన్స్. ది మ్యాగ్నిట్యూడ్ ఆఫ్ ది ఈవెంట్ ఈస్ compounded by the fact that we have representatives from more than 24 countries who have come to share their experience with us. This reminds me the Indian ethos, which strongly believe in Vasudeva Kutumbam. This Sanskrit phrase means that the entire world constitute one family. This conference provides a wonderful opportunity to meet our brothers and sisters from across the world and from lasting relations. Presently, our globalized world is closer than it seems. Issues are common and solutions need to be unanimous. Major issues which are plaguing the world, including the Indian subcontinent, are terrorism, cyber crimes, environmental degradation, and health. For example, this is one of the main issues which has affected every part of the world and has no end in sight. The judiciary needs to appropriately respond to this problem by evolving innovative principles and jurisprudence so that terrorism is kept at bay while at the same time upholding the rule of law. More importantly, globalization demands rule of law. With the increase in cross-border dealings, movements of citizens, goods and investment, there is a requirement of stronger trust between nations. This trust can be built by creating institutions with strong emphasis on the rule of law, which creates a secure environment. India has contributed to the evolution of jurisprudence in many areas, and our judgments have been cited with acceptance overwhelmingly by other jurisdictions such as the United Kingdom, Australia, Singapore, Bangladesh, and other countries in the Asian continent. A special mention needs to be made of Justice Michael Kirby, who had studied Indian jurisprudence and has cited our judgments in an umpteen number of Australian High Court judgments. Indian legal system is based on the separation of powers, independence of the judiciary, and constitutional courts with wide jurisdiction. We have a constitution which enumerates fundamental rights and duties. This constitution has been expounded by the Supreme Court in terms of the constitutional morality to make it relevant from time to time. The decision rendered by the courts in India certainly reflects the strong democratic culture prevalent in India. In our country, there is a free statutory legal aid program which covers almost 75% of the Indian population. This year, we are celebrating 25 years of the successfully providing legal aid to the poor. Another important feature is that there are nearly 64,000 panel lawyers and around 69,000 paralegal volunteers who are regularly rendering legal aid and conducting legal awareness programs. Coming to the specific topics chosen for the various sessions, it can be seen that they have international ramifications. I hope that some ideas for solutions evolve through a discussion based on the experience and expertise of the esteemed participants from different jurisdictions. The first topic, the role of judiciary in maintaining a gender-just world. The gravity of this topic stems from the fact that women constitute half the world's population, perform nearly two-thirds of work hours, receive one-tenth of the world's income, and own less than 0.01% of the world's property. Most nations have recognized equality and dignity of women, whether under the constitution or otherwise. We have all realized that merely having a lofty declarations in law would not satisfy the requirement to uplift women who are discriminated day in and day out. There is sufficient scope for the judiciary to proactively ensure a gender just world. In this context, we should realize that there cannot be any compromise in gender equality. The second session concerned the topic, role of judiciary against populism. Rule of law is the strongest tool which protects plurality. This urges judicial readiness to intervene, but only when necessary to correct or prevent a problem, what will likely to not be resolved. This topic assumes fundamental importance because populist decisions affect the constitutional rights, and more often than not, rights of one group are pitted against the rights of or interests of the other group. Hence, courts have to rise to the occasion and guard constitutional values, at the same time balance all constitutional considerations. The third session pertains to the constitution and its interpretation, which is the subject which has never had any unanimity in this approach. Internationally, a facet of constitutional interpretation has been brought to the forefront by judges like Lord Denning, Justice Marshall, Breyer, Gajendra Gadkar, Hidayatullah, Vivian Bose, and Justice Koka Subbarao. India's most prominent contribution to this debate is the evolution of the doctrine of basic structure in the celebrated case of Kesavananda Bharati versus State of Kerala. This doctrine evolved from the fact that a constitution is not merely a document laying down the grand norm. Rather, it is a process which binds generations after generations to certain promises we made ourselves while normatively imagining what our country would be. In this context, this subject requires deeper consideration based on the differing experiences of the judicial minds from across the continents and how they have dealt with the question. The fourth session concerns the topic, the role of judiciary in environmental protection and sustainable development. This topic reminds me of Mahatma Gandhi, who observed that, I quote, the future depends on what we do in the present, unquote. This issue has been a point of discussion since the beginning of this century and continue to be a main focus within global politics. The threat of environmental degradation is not mere hypocrisy or hysteria. It is real, and we are suffering the consequences of the same every day. Recently, we have witnessed earth-shattering environmental crises such as forest fires, depletion of ozone layer, climate change, increasing sea levels, etc. We must all realize these efforts are not only for the present generation, but also are a noble task to create a safe and sound environment for future generations. The fifth and final session of the conference, titled The Role of Judiciary in Protecting Privacy of Citizens in the Internet Age, is a fitting finale to this international conference, as it directly confronts an issue that concerns global citizenry pertaining to the changing theological landscape. As individuals are provided the services over the internet by international entities, there is a need to create a jurisprudence that molds together both international and national concerns. Therefore, this topic is extremely well suited to a broad-based cross-jurisdictional discussion such as the present, and it would be illuminating to hear your concerned inputs on this age right. Before I end, I am reminded Martin Luther King, who observed that, I quote, if we are to have peace on earth, our loyalties must transcend our race, our tribe, our class, and our nation. And this means we must develop a world perspective, unquote. With these few words, I would like to conclude by encouraging all of you to actively take part in the sessions and forthcoming in the discussions. I hope that these 2 days are enlightening, stimulating, and would go a long way in breaking barriers, making lifelong friends, and creating long-lasting memories. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. May I now request the Union Minister for Law and Justice Communications, Electronics and Information Technology, Mr. Ravi Shankar Prasad, to please address the Assembly.
Honourable the Prime Minister of India, forgive a little sore throat, ladies and gentlemen. Honourable the Chief Justice of India, Mr. Bob Day, distinguished judges of Supreme Court, Attorney General, Solicitor General, Law Officers, Honourable Judges of Supreme Court, Chief Justice of High Court, Judges, and distinguished delegates from abroad. Welcome to India, where we are proud of our heritage.